long ago, the Canadian independent music scene was very, very different. Believe me, I was there. And so were the heroes of our little story, the Bourbon Tabernacle Choir. Rock and roll is full of myths, most of it bullshit. But here's a story that may one day be the stuff of legend.
Easy judging when you're sitting up in your high chair.
Is gonna put his claws up there.
Ain't no experience bad enough you ever had to quit.
Might no temptation, might no shame had to come with it.
Ooh. Cry when you're hungry, you just cry when you see things.
The band, otherwise known as the Bourbons or BTC, were hot. They were the kids on the block. They rose to the fore in the mid-80s when they were 16 and 17-year-old wonder brats. They won their high school Battle of the Bands and just kept going. They recorded and toured non-stop for a decade, so inevitably they ended up burned out, broke, and at musical odds. The band split unofficially in 1995. And now, 14 years later, the Bourbons have been asked to headline the 25th anniversary of the legendary Hillside Festival. But first they have to regroup and put together a set list at Chris's cabin on Wolf Island, across from Kingston, Ontario.
I'm really looking forward to making this music together, and it's nice that it's prompted by someone from the outside saying we want this to happen, because I don't know that it would have been motivated by us internally.
Sure, I'll just put the keys in the shoe out here so you guys can just kind of come and go.
Okay.
Yeah, this is where we're gonna rehearse. On Main Street, like right here is the hotel, right on the corner, which has a restaurant. Right beside us is the Island Grill, which has a patio on the water. You can get veggie burgers there and stuff. And you know how to use a composting toilet.
Yeah, sure.
So all you do is after you use it, you just put a cup of peat in there. All right?
A cup of peat?
Yeah, there's peat moss. And then, yeah, there's a flashlight, there's wet ones, back porch. Make yourself at home.
We love wind. Renewable is doable. It is a critical part of our energy future as we strive to correct global warming, protect biodiversity, and exercise a rigorous regime of conservation. We believe that wind can be done right on Wolf Island.
Don't speed in the village.
All right.
They're proposing 86 turbines for the western portion of the island.
30 of those turbines will be situated in 2 kilometer radius of this area right here that's also been identified as the most sensitive habitat on the island.
This whole ridiculousness with the windmills, it's so crazy that we're arguing about something that should be such a wonderful time for this community.
Mm-hmm. Chris?
Yeah?
You need to get into your zone for the bourbon thing. Can you talk about what you need to do for that?
Oh, it's easy. It's just a matter of me, like, sitting and listening to songs and playing through stuff, you know? So, like, it's, you know, I'm not sweating it at all. I am getting into the headspace by driving around slowly and thinking about nature. It doesn't really conflict, you know?
It was just a matter of just seeing if the time was right. Like when Sam Bagel, you know, first proposed this from Hillside, do you think there's a chance that maybe, you know, and I kind of knew what he was driving, and I said, if the Bourbons would play a gig, I said, you know, if you'd asked me 3 years ago, I probably would have said no, but I kind of think that it might be the right time. So I just kind of put the feelers out, and some people, it was just immediately yes. Like, that's what I felt in my heart. I felt like, yeah, this is the time. Other people, there were conditions, but the conditions weren't like anybody holding out. They were just like making sure that it was done the right way, I think. It's just being pushed into old definitions of ourselves, which really don't apply anymore. Because it can't really be a step back. Like, it's got to be... it's got to be kind of welcomed into the present context of everybody's musical selves. And really at its core, it's now just really looking forward to being together and hanging out and catching up and just being sparked by everybody, you know? And if that happens, then it's going to be great, you know? This is where in my backyard. I'm not quite sure what you do. Stand there so bold to the
Here are the biopics you've been waiting for. Back in 1996, Chris Brown and vocalist Kate Fenner moved to New York City to see what could happen. They became known as Chris and Kate. They also have solo careers. The same year, Dave Wall became the voice of the Flying Bulger Klezmer Band, a Yiddish gypsy folk fusion group. Chris Miller, guitarist, has forged a career as a sound designer, sound editor, and sound recordist for film and TV. Andrew Whiteman is a rock guitarist for Broken Social Scene and his own band, Apostle of Hustle. Jason Mercer went on to prime his chops as bassist for folk icon Oni DeFranco and later for Ron Sexsmith. Mr. Gene Hardy became a session musician and has played with over 1,000 acts. And Tom Bona still keeps the rhythm. He joined the Bourbons a year before they split. He's gone on to play drums for a slew of Canadian primo acts.
It's like a memory jog, but then so much of it is dependent on all the other folks. It's not like, you know, like I can kind of remember the arrangements and stuff, but it's just like I just got to kind of touch on everything and make sure I'm kind of in that mindset. But it really
it won't really happen until it happens, you know? It's like there's only so much you can prepare, and it's just really about everybody kind of playing together again.
It's just starting to come back. That's it.
Is it now? It's 2008, so maybe 14 years ago.
Everything's up for grabs in terms of the arrangements and stuff like that. Like, they got to be kind of based on who we are now. A lyric doesn't feel right, change it, you know?
How might you react if there's some kind of conflict?
I don't know. Maybe I'll partake in it. I'm not sure. I'll definitely just join whatever side I think is, like, right, you know? The whole nature of our union was, you know, from the time we were kids, I mean, it was very, it's kind of a vulnerable space, I guess, you know? Because it wasn't anything that was predetermined or, like, it's not like anybody said, okay, let's form a band. It was just like, the band was formed when we were 15 and 16 because we were all hanging out. And so I think people kind of have to kind of fall back into that naturally. And I'm interested to see what that means.
Like, stay on the same note for the first two.
you guys want to do in the way of like work ethic today? Like, you know, we could hard nose it and then just go, okay, let's just work and until we're tired, and then let's have a dinner and just hang out.
I think as long as we get through all the songs on the list, because I think today we have to decide what we're getting rid of, what we need to really work on. So
let's expose everything. Now's the time.
Now's the time.
I don't think that happens later.
What the hell is a bridge there? Is your mouth still big enough for the two? Should we listen to this one?
How about the live version?
Yeah, that's on my iPod.
I brought that too.
Or do you want to go through stuff and figure out what we need to listen to?
That's a good idea.
That's a great
play
idea.
Try to remember how the song goes. It's been a long time. We've forgotten all these.
The language will be nonsense. Words all lose their meaning by the time they leave the tongue. Some songs ain't about it, give this whole world understand you. Words just speak for moments like the light speaks for the sun.
Take two times to be spoken. Where are the words that can't be repeated?
Like right now, I think if we could kind of move everything into the place where, oh, this feels comfortable, we can do this, we can do this, and then we could be really detail focused at the Dakota. Cool. So the open air, so we don't, Charlie sounds crazy right now.
Deliver me.
Let's say deliver me.
Ignite one more time by the time, all right.
Everyone sounds great, by the way, if I may say. Everyone sounds fantastic. Especially me.
Now I know how this band broke up.
There was this camaraderie and communal creation going on. And we really were a community. That you have a first 4 years of being in love. And then we realized that we're in a van and we're playing 250 gigs. And it's about stamina.
And we, for whatever reason, we decided that we lost the vibe and it was time to stop.
For me, I think one of the fractures that occurred was that wondering about that dependence on so many people, you know? And I don't know if it manifested in everybody else in different ways, but
I remember having that feeling that when it was tenuous, going, oh my God, like you're depending on so many factors to pull this thing off.
Towards the end, I remember, because your songwriting, Chris, was getting more and more personal.
Uh-huh.
And I remember this feeling, well, why are Kate and I singing this? Why am I singing this? Not bullshit.
No, I know.
Well, the words weren't very good and the music wasn't too good, but I remember thinking that I felt like a middleman or like a...
Sure.
Like I was kind of filtering it.
I know, I was spiraling inward. So have been ever since, actually. It's, you should see what I'm seeing right now.
Nice.
Climb your ladder, every rung.
All the beauty.
Find the songs still left unsung.
Find the songs still left unsung.
All the beauty.
Like old Plato, wisely see. Look behind the
screen to see.
The screen to see.
Find
the road and we will travel.
All the beauty.
Find a road and we will travel.
I forgot all about that song.
How about that song?
So you worked with
Oh, that is
trying to pretend. I'm
here.
I'm yelling name correctly.
I'm the director of Tim Brooks.
Oh, that's fine.
Yeah, for real. Yeah, the man who created his name.
Do you have to tell me you understand?
Right, so
my mother used to take those.
And
she knows her mummy and daddy are pretty good.
Oh, is that right?
Someone help him. Someone help him.
So don't hit anything. He's in a reverie.
What would that be?
It really was rock school, you know, and more than that, it was like not just the music, it was the social aspect. I mean, the Bourbons were really born, I think, out of a social scene more than a musical scene.
There is like a lot of history, you know, not just silly stuff, not just jokes and drinks, but, you know, books we read together, things we discovered at the same time, music, films, because this whole thing started in high school, you know, and Chris and I were friends in high school. You know, some of my closest friends are, you know, in this band are in high school, but in the world, so.
This was my finishing school. This was my master's degree in playing music in a great band. This was such a definitive experience in my career. Like, I carry this with me everywhere.
You know, we gave everything to it. Heart and soul, and we really, it really defined who we were in a lot of ways. And of course, we were so involved, so deeply involved in the music and traveling all the time that we didn't have time to develop other skills, playing with other people or, you know, jamming with other bands. And of course, it takes time to kind of redefine yourself. And I really considered quitting music at that time.
Was it hard for you when the band split?
It was weird to have all that time on my hands. It was also weird making money, because we made no money. But that wasn't the experience. There were so many mouths to feed.
Well, I used to basically launch myself at everything like I was singing the national anthem. Like, there was no, like, gradation. It was like, you know, I really, 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 really mean this. And now I feel less. I feel like I don't have to do that as much, that there's enough going on. And it takes a lot of strain off the voice. I mean, now we practiced 8 hours yesterday, so I sound a little bit like a foghorn. But yeah, just a little less. I don't want to say urgency, because the urgency is still there. It's something else. But it just makes it a little less panicked or something.
The first tune, it was kind of like being eased back into it. It was just, I never ever thought this day would come. I figured we were done. And
I was open to it, for sure. And so it tickled my fancy, kind of. You know, I thought, that would be weird enough to be fun.
I think I was resisting the idea of revisiting something and having to go back there, like the idea that I'd have to sort of act like a 22-year-old again or whatever, and look like a 22-year-old. And then once you're together and you're sort of finding your way through the stuff again, it doesn't feel like that. So that's good. I just like to keep things moving. No stopping and staring, let's just go. So it's good to slow down once in a while and actually go, oh, this was my life. That's interesting.
We're leaving in about 15 minutes, the noon ferry boat back to Kingstown. And we'll see everybody in 2 weeks for some fine tuning. It's gonna be fun. It's gonna be a riot.
Bye. Hey, bye. Juliet, you be nice to Dave. He's a very confused man.
I thought we got rid of you.
I didn't get my stuff together.
Godspeed.
It feels to me, just hanging with everybody, I feel like we kind of set ourselves up on a good path. We held ourselves to really good standards socially and otherwise, you know, and lovingly. Like, I mean, that band played at my father's funeral on the altar, you know? We were really there for each other in a very profound way, and they were very exacting standards to kind of live up to. So if you're not doing that, if you're not playing in that band, then you better fucking mean what you're doing. Because you just walked away from something that was about as real as you're gonna see.
There's so much stuff.
What kind of stuff?
Old, newspaper clippings. And, like, there's just a couple, there's kind of a bit of an archive of stuff from when we were kids that just has lingered. Box has old newspaper articles and stuff in it. You're welcome to it.
Your limit wore out last year, so I'm actually the official owner
Lee's
of all
Palace.
This.
Yes.
This is great. This is interesting because the Onks were like their newsletter, which was
their fan relation.
This is great stuff. I'm never giving any of this back.
This is awesome. Look at that.
At the time, the Bourbons were interesting because they actually managed to. They were like one of the few bands that really managed to break. Without breaking, like they broke onto the Canadian scene, like really strongly in the university market without any technology really of any kind.
So this is a band that was pervasive, and if you were sort of in your mid 30s and you were going out to see live music, you were going to see the Bourbons.
You know, we used to go to Lee's Palace for concerts, and of course, you know, Stephen Page would show up and just sort of hang out, or Big Sugar would come by.
That's right.
And they would just sort of hang out. And, you know, maybe Dave Bedini would show up. And then you've got, the Bourbons and the Rios doing the Neil Young collaboration.
The whole scene was really...
incestuous?
Yeah, and it's funny, you know, because it's novel. Kind of like the Bourbons and that whole scene were almost like the unsigned indie test ground of that kind of thing that then ended up happening with Broken Social Scene and Andrew. And Andrew being in that band is kind of interesting because he's the link. And those guys actually from Bourbon Social Scene were also around and friends with them during the early...
Yep, but you know, the vantage that...
You guys are experts on this. So that's kind of like...
I don't know what that says about us.
Seven, E minor, seven, so I can see.
I think that to me feels like a form. Like on the fourth one we retard, we do that.
We have played that line a bunch of times in the song, so it's not like it's brand new. It's not like it's brand new. Like we have played that line a bunch of times, or you feel it's like, whoa, just keep
it
on.
It feels like it's getting
big. Yeah. And then all I'm doing is.
I can't remember where I was. Is that where you were?
May I make a suggestion?
So that's just fun.
When we come back to the tonic chord.
I feel like I'm like developing all my 19-year-old bad singing
habits. Wicked. Like, that's what we're here for.
The tense thing.
And not taking breath.
So let's just do the intro the way we sing a chorus, but twice as long.
Oh, what? But the it's nice part about the thing is the nice weavy part of it.
Yeah. I don't mean I'm just saying. It seemed to be awkward getting off of that nice weavy thing going into the top of the song. The band doesn't know what to do.
But he's trying to help you get.
I'm next to my heart.
Next to my skin. It's where my issues start. How can I love?
Right, which is how we were singing it, but if we think of it like the chorus, it's easier to.
Last line,
yeah, it's
saying.
Easier to drop.
What would be nice is under that vocal thing out. I think it'd be great if one of the guitarists could do that bridge line.
The first half of that phrase is Petra.
Okay, can someone tell me how we play that turnaround? Here.
1, 1, 6, 2, 5.
Okay, but then 1, 6, 2, 5.
4.
Okay. Got it. Sorry. Can we do a whole thing again?
I'm sort of worried that it's just we have so much work to do because it's very loose. And I think we're all feeling, it's not panic, but that slight tension that we're going to be in front of thousands of people in like 4 days, and it's not quite as easy as we thought.
It's really daunting, really, because even though it's a handful of songs, there's a lot going on, and it's stuff that we had down pat 13 years ago.
It's feeling like we kind of need to leave details alone. It's kind of about just plowing through things and letting all the mistakes happen and then just go, oh. So I don't think anybody's even thinking about the audience right now.
How can I describe it? It's funny coming back to these songs and arrangements that we did, you know, 13, 14 years ago. And playing them now with the sort of headspace that we're all in now. A lot of people play different kinds of music. A lot of people have been, you know, changing the way they play and approach things. And we come back to this stuff to try and play it the way we did. Doesn't always work.
And you have 2 more rehearsals.
Only 2 more, yeah.
And you only got through about 4 songs today?
We only got through 4 songs today, out of 13.
The concert on Saturday the Hillside Music Festival sold out has been for months. There'll be tens of thousands of people, rain or shine. The question is, will they be ready? Will they pull it off? And if they do, will they do it again?
Yesterday something happened, it all fell into this place that, like, all of a sudden there was something invisible and solid there that we could all kind of lean up against, you know? Didn't feel like we were propping anything up anymore, you know? And that was a great feeling. And I think once we had that happen, then everybody just opened up, you know? Fenner and meet them through this way of through their dear friend Andrew, who they've been in the band with, and now we sort of were doing the same thing with rotating singers and rotating musicians around, and the focus was all over the place. So I think Andrew really found that comforting because he grew up musically that way.
When I left university, I was editor of this magazine, and we used to organize a lot of fundraisers for the magazine, and that's when Chris Brown and I started becoming good friends, because Chris just took on this role of organizing fundraisers for the magazine. And so he would bring in people like Hayden and the Bare Naked Ladies, and, like, we would have these incredible fundraisers. And then Dave played at our wedding. He sang God Bless Our Love. Yeah.
I did actually cover the Bourbons. I did a story for them on the New Music when I was hosting the show. They were Canada's favorite bar band. They could sell at any venue in Canada for more than a decade, and yet had never had radio success, never had a hit, etc., etc., etc. And my premise was that they lacked assertiveness. They were missing some rock and roll, like, you know, nastiness, ruthlessness, something that would allow them to break through.
They opened for the Bare Naked Ladies in a hockey arena in Baysville, Ontario, and it was the sexiest thing I'd ever seen. When you're a kid, right, I was like 17, 16, and it was hot, it was like erotic. Before internet, before sort of a mass media takeover, there was a Toronto scene that was really important, and really, I think that you could feel it across Canada, and definitely the Bourbons were a part of that.
It was his vision, his one wish, for the 25th anniversary Hillside, was to ask our next performers if they would please on the Hillside come together. They said yes. They spent last week rehearsing, and it's because of the man we're about to bring out. Please welcome Mr. Sam Pagel.
Without further ado, please, please welcome the Bourbon Tabernacle Choir.
Thanks so very much. How's everybody doing? We're so happy to see y'all.
Let's not compete. An end is beginning. A body's retreat. There's no perfect silence. And no selfish sound. This pain we can share it. There's enough to go around. So let's keep this simple. And space won't defeat us. No pity, no pedestals. No distance to cheat us. We're right at the edge now, yeah, and ready to fall from instinct and reason. To nothing else. Experts must suffer. It's so much wiser to stay dumb and pay attention to our heartbeats. Oh, here they come, here they come. Well, here come the bullets, and here come the nails, the shots that we fire, attachments we. So let's break this right down. I know the changes sound wrong. It's time to dispose all arrangements. And time to get down to the soul.